You must have heard about physician's sample. That is a small part of the formulation that is given to the medical doctor or physician for him to use it and to observe it. Every drug, so the DNC rules and regulations say that every drug intended for distribution to the medical profession as a free sample shall, while complying with the labeling provisions under clauses 1 to 8, which we saw previously, further bear on the label of the container the words physician's sample not to be sold, which has to be overprinted. Okay. Another important point is, if any preparation contains not less than 3% by volume of alcohol, the quantity of alcohol shall be stated in terms of the average percentage by volume of absolute alcohol in the finished products. So these are two important points that we just saw here, that drugs that are intended to be given to the physician for use as physician's sample should contain all the matter that is mandatory on the label of any regular formulation. In addition, the words physician's sample not to be sold needs to be overprinted on that label. Secondly, as long as the formulation contains less than 3% volume by volume of alcohol, it need not be declared on the label. However, if the content of alcohol exceeds this amount, then the same should be stated on the label in terms of average percent by volume of absolute alcohol. Okay, yet one more important point. We have seen in the previous slide where I showed you example labels that the manufacturing date was given as 04/06, which is the month and the year. As I told you very specifically, the date should not be mentioned. The reason is this. For the purpose of this rule, the date of expiry shall be in terms of month and year, and it means that the drug is recommended till the last day of the month. Okay. The date of expiry is preceded by the words expiry date or EXP date, whatever it is. The main important point to note here is that if you buy a formulation from the market and its shelf life, or rather its date of expiry, is given as June 2021, you can still use it safely till 30th June, after which it is not recommended for usage. Thus, once again, the date of expiry is in terms of month and year. I've shown this example to you. And it shall mean that the drug is recommended till the last day of the month on which it is supposed to expire. In addition to the other particulars which are required to be printed or written under these rules, the label of the innermost container of the following categories of drugs and every other covering in which the container is packed shall bear a conspicuous red vertical line on the left side running throughout the body of the label, and this band should not be less than 1 mm in width, and it should be printed on the label for these categories of drugs, that includes narcotics, analgesics, hypnotics, sedatives, tranquilizers, corticosteroids, hormones, hypoglycemics, antimicrobials, antiepileptics, antidepressants, anticoagulants, anti-cancer drugs, and all drugs that fall under schedule G, H, and X, whether or not covered in this list. So what this tells us is that there are certain categories of drugs for which precautions are needed, and therefore it is recommended and mandatory to have a red line, a red thin band running through the left side of the label, and it does not disturb the other conditions. Some of the drug categories for which this is mandatory includes analgesics, hypnotics, sedatives, tranquilizers, corticosteroids, hormones, hypoglycemics, antimicrobials, anti-epileptics, antidepressants, anticoagulants, anti-cancer drugs, drugs falling under schedule G, H and X. Observe the label of an ibuprofen tablet. As you can see, all the conditions we have discussed so far have been complied with, along with an additional requirement that is specified in the DNC Act and Rules, that is the presence of a red band at the left hand side for categories of drugs including NSAIDs, which brufen is. Okay, so remember, it is very important to have this red line running along the left hand side of the label without disturbing the other matter for certain categories of drugs which are specified as per the DNC Act and Rules. The container of a medicine for internal use shall, if it contains a substance specified in Schedule G, then be labeled with the words, caution, it is dangerous to take this preparation except under medical supervision. So these are special instructions that are to be put on the label if the drug belongs to Schedule G. And these words should be conspicuous, that means visible, and surrounded by a line or a box within which there shall be no other words. I will explain this to you with the help of an example in the next slide. Similarly, if the container contains a substance or drug specified in Schedule H, then it should be labeled with the symbol RX and conspicuously displayed on the left top corner of the label, that is RX, and also labeled with the words Schedule H drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. Thus, there are special instructions if the drug belongs to Schedule G or the drug belongs to Schedule H. In case of a Schedule G drug, the instructions that are given include, caution, it is dangerous to take this preparation except under medical supervision. In case of Schedule H drug, the symbol RX should be displayed on the left top corner, as well as the warning, Schedule H drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. As I move to the next slide, I will show you one label. Okay, coming to this label, you can see the top left hand corner is RX. So it's a Schedule H drug, and the Schedule H drug warning is displayed, to be sold on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. And you can see that these wordings are inside a box in which no other wordings are displayed. Okay, so this is how the pharma company which is marketing the drug makes sure that all the provisions that are laid down in the DNC Act and Rules are complied with. So right from the top of the label to the bottom of the label, read each and everything that is printed. You will come to know that all the specifications, all the regulations are being complied with. So take a look at this label. Let us pause here and take a look at this label. I will not explain anything to you right here because I have been explaining each and every point to you as we go along. I will just keep circling it. So start thinking what has been told to you earlier about this point. Isn't it? All this has been explained to you. And I hope you can understand each and every aspect of this label and know that it is all mandatory. special instructions. Fixed information which is printed and variable information that is overprinted. We now move on to what the DNC Act tells us about the packing of drugs. What does the word packing of drugs mean to you? When you go to a pharmacist to buy a particular drug, he or she will dispense a bottle of liquid syrup, a strip or a blister of tablets, a tube containing ointment. Isn't it? You must have noticed there is some commonality between these packs. Generally, you will see that syrups are sold in bottles of 50 ml or 100 ml. Tablets and capsules are sold in blister packs of 10 tablets or 15 tablets or 5 tablets. So there is a common element in all these which is there precisely because the DNC Act says so. Therefore, in this section, we are going to look at the provisions of the DNC Act that define the packing of drugs. So, let us see what the section says. Unless specified in Schedule P1, so leaving aside the exceptions, the common rule is that the pack size for tablets or capsules shall be, where the number of tablets, whether it is coated or uncoated, or capsules is less than 10, then such packing shall be made, so it is mandatory, by the integral number. So it could be 4, it could be 7, it could be 8. For numbers above 10, the pack size of the tablets or capsules shall be in multiples of 5. So where the number of tablets and capsules is 9 or less, you can have any number of tablets or capsules in a strip. It could be 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, whatever. But if it is 10 and more, then the pack sizes will be 10 tablets, 15 tablets, 20, 25, 30, and so on. The pack sizes for liquid oral preparations shall be 30 ml only for pediatric preparations, or 60 ml or 100 ml or 200 ml, or the biggest size that is permissible is 450 ml. Thus, there is a defined pack size which has to be adhered to by the manufacturer of the formulation. In case of pediatric oral drops, the dose or the pack size is 5 ml or 10 ml or 15 ml. So, right now in this section on packing of drugs, we have looked at the pack sizes permissible for tablets and capsules, pack sizes permissible for liquid oral preparations, and pack sizes permissible for pediatric oral drops. The pack size for eye, ear, or nasal drop shall be 3 ml or 5 ml or 10 ml. The pack size for eye ointment shall be 3 grams, 5 grams or 10 grams. However, there are exceptions. Provided that the provisions of the pack sizes which we have just read so far shall not apply to pack sizes or dosage forms not covered by the provisions of this rule. So, the packs that are given in Schedule P1 will not comply with these general rules. Imported formulations, when they are imported in their final finished pack, in whatever size they are available abroad, the same size will be sold here. The same pack would be sold here. Similarly, these are provisions are not applicable to preparations meant for veterinary use. These provisions are not applicable to preparations that are intended to be exported. So, the pack size will be as per the requirements of that particular country and its regulatory agency. Vitamins, tonics, cough preparations, antacids, laxatives in liquid oral forms and other unit dose such as applicaps need not comply with the provisions that are given above. Pack sizes of dosage forms meant for retail sale to hospitals, registered medical practitioners, nursing homes, government clinics, etc. again do not fall under the provisions given here. Samples for purpose of distribution to physician or what are called as physician samples need not comply with the provisions given above. Lastly, the pack sizes of large volume IV fluids also will depend on the usage rather than the term conditions given here. Next is a very important instruction, and that is the provisions for instructions on the label of preparations meant for ophthalmic use. So what are those instructions that are meant to be visible on the label of any ophthalmic preparation? Let us see. We first go to ophthalmic solutions and suspensions. Most of the eye drops that are instilled into the eyes for topical use are present as either solutions or suspensions. The difference between solutions and suspensions is that in a solution, all the components are dissolved, so you have a clear solution. As against that, a suspension contains the drug and maybe other excipients in the finely distributed divided form and is suspended in the liquid formulation. So what are the instructions that are additional particulars that need to be shown on the label of ophthalmic solutions or suspensions includes the statement, use the solution within 1 month after opening the container. Name and concentration of the preservative if it is used in the preparation. The words not for injection. Any special instructions regarding storage if necessary. A warning or a cautionary legend in such as if irritation persists or increases, discontinue the use and consult physician. Do not touch the dropper tip or any other dispensing tip to any surface since this may contaminate the solution. So you can see there are a number of instructions, labeling instructions that are necessary to be installed onto a label which is affixed onto the container that holds the ophthalmic solution or suspension. I repeat once again the important instructions. Use the solution within 1 month after opening the container. Remember, the containers contain ophthalmic solutions or suspensions and it is meant for multiple uses. So there are multiple doses within one container. This container is going to be opened and closed multiple number of times. During the usage, accidental touching of the tip can lead to contamination. Hence, it is very important to have an instruction, use solution within 1 month after opening the container. The formulation that is held within the container does contain preservative, but this preservative cannot prevent contamination if the contamination occurs several times during the opening and closing. Hence, it has been determined by using various tests that such a solution, once the tip of the cap is opened, should be used within 1 month of opening the container. Next, name and concentration of the preservative if used. The words not for injection, special storage instructions, two warnings. One is if irritation persists or increases, discontinue use and consult physician. The second warning, do not touch the dropper tip or any other dispensing tip to any surface since this may contaminate the solution. The other commonly used ophthalmic preparation is an ointment on which these instructions will come. Also, special instructions regarding storage wherever needed are to be included. Also, the warning: if irritation persists or increases, discontinue use and consult physician is necessary. In front of you now is a label of an ophthalmic product which we are going to read in order to understand whether all the mandatory instructions have been included on the label. So let us start with the name, the title. You have the chemical name, you have the brand name, and now coming to the special instructions of the label. You have the ingredients being given, name and quantities, instructions as directed, use as directed by the physician. Use the solution within 1 month after opening the vial. Store the vial well closed in a cool place. So that's a special instruction. Warning is given here: if irritation persists or increases, discontinue the use and consult the physician. Do not touch the vial tip to any surface since this may contaminate the solution. Finally, you have two more instructions: not for injection, for external use only. And because the drug is a scheduled drug, then you have a warning which also says to be sold by retail on the prescription of a medical practitioner only. Thus, you can see that all the provisions that we learnt so far about ophthalmic preparations have been adhered to and complied with during the designing stage of this label. We have thus looked at the provisions applicable to the manufacture, sale, labeling and packing of all allopathic drugs. Similarly, the DNC Act and rules has laid down the provisions applicable to manufacture, sale, labeling and packaging of Ayurvedic drugs. Provisions applicable to the manufacture, sale, packing, labeling of homeopathic drugs, and the provisions applicable to manufacture, sale, labeling and packaging of cosmetics. They are more or less similar in nature and are given in the DNC Act and rules. All of you are therefore recommended to go through the same and understand for yourself the provisions for these Ayurvedic drugs or homeopathic drugs or cosmetics, and revert back and come to me with any doubts if you're having. This portion is left to you all to study on yourself, by yourself, and ask me the relevant doubts. I will now push forward to the next section, that is the labeling and packaging of cosmetics. Another important topic which I have started right now is the labeling and packaging of cosmetics. We all have seen the attractive containers that hold various types of cosmetics. Cosmetics are nothing but formulations with a very high aesthetic value and a usage that is generally restricted to the external surface of the skin or the hair, etc. Isn't it? A cosmetic, so let us look at the labeling aspects. A cosmetic shall carry on both the inner and the outer labels the name of the cosmetic, very important. Name of the manufacturer and the complete address of the premises of the manufacturer where the cosmetic has been manufactured. However, if the cosmetic is contained in a very small container where the address of the manufacturer cannot be given, then the name of the manufacturer and his principal place of manufacture should be given along with PIN code. Because there are various pack sizes in cosmetics, all of which differ from each other, some small, some big. It is observed that the smaller containers do not have adequate space to put the name and complete address of, let us say, the marketing and the production area of where the cosmetic is being manufactured. In such a case, it is enough if the name of the manufacturer and principal place of address, let us say Goa, is given along with the PIN code. The complete postal address need not be there on the label. On the outer label, a declaration of the net contents expressed in terms of weight for solids such as talcum powder, fluid measure for liquids as in shampoo, weight for semi-solids, cold creams, combined with the numerical count if the content is subdivided. So the contents have to be expressed, so the brand name has to be expressed on the label. The contents have to be expressed in terms of either weight or fluid measure such as ml or weight in grams or number of units 6, 7, 8, 10 as the case may be. Provided that such a statement does need not appear in case of a pack of perfume or toilet water or the like, the net content of which does not exceed 60 ml or any package of solid or semi-solid cosmetic, the net content of which does not exceed 30 grams. On the inner label where a hazard exists, then it is necessary to include adequate directions for safe use. Any warning, caution, or special direction required to be observed by the consumer, and a statement of the names and quantities of the ingredients that are hazardous or poisonous. Thus, if any cosmetic contains some ingredient which may be hazardous though not dangerous, then adequate directions for safe use, warnings, special warnings, precautions, as well as names and quantities of those ingredients need to be mentioned on the cosmetic label. Just as in case of formulations, cosmetics also require, the label of the cosmetic also requires a distinctive batch number which represents the batch and being preceded by the letter B. So the batch number should have the unique batch number before which you can either have B or B number, provided this clause shall not apply to any cosmetic containing 10 grams or less if the cosmetic is solid or semi-solid state, and 25 ml or less if the cosmetic is in a liquid state. Thus, for large volume containers of cosmetics, a batch number is necessarily to be established on the label, which is not so if the cosmetic is present in extremely small quantities such as less than 10 grams or less than 25 ml. In the case of soaps, instead of batch number, the month and year of soap shall be given on the label. So this is relevant to the FMCG industry, that soaps do not contain batch number, rather the month and year of the manufacture of soap will be given on the label. Moving forward, what else are the requirements for labels designed for cosmetics? Manufacturing license number, the number being preceded by the letter M. Where the package of cosmetic has only one label, then this label has to necessarily contain all the information required to be shown on both the inner and the outer label as per the DNC Act and rules. So all of you should know that the label, if there are two labels, the information can be split between the two labels. However, if the cosmetic is going to contain only one label, no secondary packing like carton packing, then all the information required on the both the inner and outer labels has to be shown on a single label. We now look at the labeling, packing and limit of alcohol in Ayurvedic, including Siddha or Yunani drugs. There shall be conspicuously displayed on the label of the container or package of an Ayurvedic or Siddha or Yunani drug the true list of all ingredients used in the manufacture of this preparation together with the quantity of each of the ingredients incorporated therein and a reference to the method of preparation thereof as detailed in the standard text and adhikarana as are prescribed in the authoritative books specified in the first schedule to the act. Provided that if the list of ingredients contained in the medicine is large and cannot be accommodated on the label, then the same may be printed separately and enclosed with the packing and reference be made to this effect on the label. So what does this slide tell us about the labeling and packaging requirements for Ayurveda or Siddha or Yunani drugs? Is that on the label is present a true list of all ingredients that are used in the manufacture of the preparation. Quantity is mentioned as well as there is a reference to the method of preparation. So just like you have an ingredient, active ingredient being mentioned on the label of an allopathic container that contains allopathic drug. Similarly, in Ayurvedic preparations or Siddha or Yunani preparations, list of all ingredients with quantities is mandated on the label. However, if the container is small, then the label may be prepared separately and issued separately to the patient. The container of a medicine for internal use made up ready for the treatment of human ailments shall, if it is made up from a substance specified in Schedule E1, be labeled conspicuously with the words caution to be taken under medical supervision in both the English and Hindi language. Following particulars shall be either printed or written in indelible ink, that is washproof ink, and shall appear in a conspicuous manner on the label of the innermost container of any Ayurvedic or Yunani drug or any other in which covering in which the container is packed. So, the particulars of the package of the container that should appear on the package of the container are name of the drug and a correct statement of the net content in terms of weights or measure or number as the case may be. So, whenever you see a label of any preparation which is Ayurvedic or Siddha or Yunani, you will find that the innermost container, that is the container in which the final formulation is packed, should necessarily contain the name of the drug as well as a statement of the net contents. Also necessary are name and address of the manufacturer, the number of the license under which the drug is being manufactured, like I told you the significance of license number, the figure representing the manufacturing license number, being preceded by ML, so you have to write manufacturing license number or MFG LIC or simply ML to indicate that the this is the license number, license for manufacture. A distinctive batch number being preceded by the words batch number or B.NO or simply B or lot can be used to establish the identity of the batch by putting its batch number. So the license number is important, the batch number is important. Lastly, the date of manufacture is important. So the date of manufacture shall be the date of completion of the final product or the date of bottling or packing of the product. The word Ayurvedic medicine or Siddha medicine or Yunani medicine should be visible to all. The words for external use only shall be put on the label if the medicine is for external use only. Every drug that is intended for distribution to the medical profession as a free sample shall not only comply with all the above said labeling provisions, however, they should also bear on the label of the container the word physician's sample not to be sold. Okay, so where the variable information about batch number, shelf life, expiry comes, the word physician's sample not to be sold will be overprinted. The Ayurvedic preparations such as asavas, which have a high content of alcohol as base, will be asked to submit the name of the drug, the maximum pack size of the drug, and submit it to the regulatory authorities. So this is just an example to help you understand what is a preparation which contains more than 15% alcohol and whether and how it is supposed to be handled. Now you can see here are examples of Ayurvedic preparations with high content of alcohol. In such a case, the maximum amount of formulation that can be dispensed is also given here. Thus, preparations which contain self-generated alcohol will also have a high alcohol content, and the as you can see, they have a high alcohol content as high as 16%. So the maximum pack size permitted is accordingly reduced to either 30 ml or 120 ml. Let us now understand the penalty that is applicable for those who manufacture or sell the drugs in contravention of this chapter. By contravention, I mean that whatever terms and conditions are laid down for the various activities to be carried out preceding the sale of the drug or cosmetic, when all the provisions are not met with, then and if inspection takes place, then the manufacturer or the person responsible for carrying out that activity is penalized, and this penalty includes whoever manufactures for sale or distribution or sells or stocks or exhibits or offers for sale or distributes any drug that is deemed to be adulterated or which when used for the diagnosis, treatment, mitigation or prevention of any disease or disorder is likely to cause his death or is or as would amount to grievous hurt solely on account of such a drug being adulterated or spurious or not of standard quality as the case may be, then the such an offense shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 5 years but which could extend to life, and with a fine not less than 10,000 rupees. Okay, so this is the penalty that a manufacturer has to bear if he does not comply with the provisions of the law with respect to drugs and cosmetics. The penalty for manufacture or sale of any drug that is deemed to be adulterated or the manufacture or sale of drug without valid license, in both these cases, the offense is punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 1 year but which may extend up to 3 years and with a fine that is not less than 5,000 rupees. So as you can see, the offenses with respect to drugs are serious crimes and the penalty is very heavy. Any drug that is deemed to be spurious but shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 3 years but which may extend up to 5 years with a fine which shall not be less than 5,000 rupees. Any drug that other than a drug that is spurious or adulterated and any offense committed with respect to the drug shall be punishable with an imprisonment for a term that shall not be less than 1 year but which may extend up to 2 years and a fine. We now look at the penalty for manufacture or sale or import, etc., of cosmetics in contravention of this chapter. Whoever himself or by any other person on his behalf manufactures for sale or manufactures for distribution or sells or even stocks or exhibits or offers for sale any cosmetic that is deemed to be spurious shall be punishable with an imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years and fine. Anyone who manufactures or sells or stocks any cosmetic other than a cosmetic referred to in the clause 1 above shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term that may extend up to 1 year plus fine or both. We now look at the penalties that are applicable to both drugs and cosmetics in case of non-disclosure of the name of the manufacturer or penalty for improper documentation or penalty for manufacture, etc. of drugs and cosmetics in contravention of particular section. So, coming first to penalty for non-disclosure of the name of the manufacturer, whoever contravenes the provisions of this section shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 1 year or with fine or with both. Whereas the penalty for not keeping documents or a similar action or for non-disclosure of information is that whoever without a reasonable cause or excuse contravenes the provisions of particular section, such a person or manufacturer shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 1 year or with a fine which may extend to 1000 rupees or both. Lastly, the penalty for manufacture of drugs or cosmetics in contravention of section 26A is that whoever himself or any other person on his behalf manufactures or sells or distributes any drug or cosmetic in contravention of the provisions given under section 26A, such a manufacturer shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years, also liable to a fine which may extend up to 5000 rupees or both. As I explained earlier, drug inspector may pick up the samples for analysis and send it to the drug analyst for testing. The drug analyst will test the material and generate a report which is also shared with the party from whom the sample has been collected. Misuse of such a government analyst report for the purpose of advertising can have serious consequences. Whoever uses any report of a test or analysis made by the Central Drugs Laboratory or by a government analyst, if he uses such a report fully or any extract from such a report for the purpose of advertising his drug, then such an offense shall be punishable with a fine which may extend up to 500 rupees. If this offense is committed again and again, serious note would be taken and more stringent action will be initiated. I would like to wind up this section by mentioning about the schedules to the DNC Act. There are two schedules to the DNC Act and these are annexures. The first schedule contains the names of the books under the Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani systems and which are to be referred while making these formulations as well as labeling or analyzing these formulations. The second schedule consists of standards to be complied with by imported drugs and by drugs manufactured for sale, sold or stocked or exhibited for
sale or distribution. So these are standards to be complied with by imported drugs, whereas Schedule 1 contains a list of the names of the drugs, of the books that fall under the Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani systems.